So we're here at Villa René Lalique in Alsace. This is actually where I make my glasses, right next door in the factory of Lalique. And annually we do our Alsace tastings here. And there's myself, James Suckling, wine critic, Jack Suckling, and also senior editor Nick Stock. And we've tasted over 500 wines from Alsace. And it's been a really interesting and exciting tasting at the same time. There's such a crazy amount of differences in all the wines, whether it's Riesling, Gewürz, Pinot Gris, Pinot Noir, Sylvaner, sweet, dry. There's so much going on here, which I think really reflects the soils and also the wine producers here. What do you think, Jack?
Yeah, I think for me, I've been pretty amazed by all the different kind of, well, partly obviously the terroirs, but also actually the different styles of all the producers. I mean, some who are making, obviously picking slightly later. Obviously oak is not too much used here, but some people even experimenting with that. And then obviously the big thing for me has been the people's view on sweetness. I mean, it's been slightly crazy. I mean, most of the wines here do have a degree of residual sugar, but of course there is a huge spectrum of some people who are really trying to ferment pretty much dry, and then other people who are really pushing it out there, and you know, things which are, you would think were dry wines actually have significant amounts of residual sugar, 8 grams, 10 grams, 12 grams. So it's pretty crazy, just all these different approaches here.
Yeah, I think that's also very confusing as a taster, but also as a wine lover, that you have these, you buy a wine and you're not sure if it's dry or sweet. So you really have to know the wines, or at least look at tasting notes from people, or from, you know, whether it's ourselves or wine merchants or whomever, so you can have an idea before of what the wines are all about. It's not that clear. What do you think, Nick?
Yeah, I mean, I know, you know, as we've written our notes these last few days, we've been very, very careful to try and indicate exactly what's going on in the palate in terms of sweetness. And it's doing the tasting, it's quite interesting, because you smell some wines, you think, oh yeah, this is going to be sweet. And on the palate, it winds out to dryness, and vice versa. You smell some wines, you think, oh, wow. And you go into the palate expecting something quite dry, and then it's like, oh, sugar. So it is really something you have to, you know, you've just got to do that extra kind of little checkbox kind of moment on the sweetness. And really, the thing I've been sort of thinking about in the background of all the tastings this week is, when do you drink these wines? You know, like the wines that are big, rich styles with a lot of texture, quite high alcohol, a lot of phenolics, sugar, often botrytis as well. You know, like I'm really trying to put myself into the mind of when I drink these wines. And, you know, it's probably, I don't know, like Australia's a long way away, Thailand is a long way, Hong Kong's a long way away. But I think about going home, I kind of think I'm going to take them to a spicy meal, like to get that sweetness and that sort of forgiving palate texture, that softness. It's almost like, you know, it's like cushions for the palate kind of sort of stuff. And I really want to put these wines into some quite spicy kind of culinary environments.
I think that's the definitely, and that's the, let's say,
which
the,
you don't get the, here in Alsace, by the way.
No,
there ain't a chili in sight,
which is funny. But that's the cliche for Chinese, Thai, Asian food, is Alsace wines, particularly Gewürztraminer. But at the same time, I think that the wines that we tend to gravitate towards are much more fresh, firm, compacted wines that'll go with just about everything. And I would say that, generally speaking, we like to drink them with like the first course or even as an aperitif, but there's no way that they're these big, rich, off dry or even sweet styles of wines from Alsace. And that's really interesting, because like you said, well, who are people making these wines for if it doesn't go with their local cuisine, except for maybe really creamy dishes or desserts? So it is, we don't really have the answers. We've spoken to a number of wine producers, and we'll speak to a few more tonight, but even they don't have a complete handle on it. And it's even interesting that out in the wine world, we're reading some stuff from some masters of wine, and they were talking about how Alsace makes dry wines and Germany makes sweet wines, which is actually completely not the case anymore. You can't generalize like this. Yes, indeed, there are dry producers that tend to make drier wines like Trimbach or Hügel, but I would say in general, most of the wines are sweet in Alsace. And ironically, I think of most of the wines in, at least wines in Germany are dry now. So anyways, I think there's a lot of confusion in the market still. And I think that also even for producers, it's confusing for them. And it's also perhaps why Alsace is having a pretty difficult time in the market, because people just don't know what they're buying.
I think for me, I find that kind of the Vendange, Tardives, the STNs, for me, those actually, I can place them. Like, I know where they're at. And I conversely, I understand the bone dry stars. It's the ones kind of that sort of sit in the middle in the kind of halfway house that sometimes it's hard to sort of grasp where exactly they're getting at. What occasion would you serve those ones? I mean, I think the really, really sweet stars, personally, I don't really have the stamina to drink those right at the end of the night. I mean, but at the end of the night with a dessert, I'm just want something light. I want to sleep well. So I think those really, really sweet stars, the luscious late harvest stars, I actually like them at the beginning of a meal. But I think just the ones where like I say, in the middle, those are sometimes I struggle to know exactly when I wanted to drink those stars.
Yeah, I totally agree. It's almost like if you're going to go deep, I want to go deep, all the bells, all the whistles, really, really push the boat out. And if you want to go sharp, if you want to go edgy, I want to go really edgy, really tense, get some real excitement. I want the hairs to raise on my arms in those really dry styles.
Yeah.
But I don't want to be just bobbing around in the ocean of kind of whatever in the middle. And there is kind of a lot of that wine. I wonder, like, one of the things, and I don't know, you've been thinking about it a lot in the last few days, trying to get your head around, what it is that means the styles of wines that are being made here are the styles they're making. I wonder about, the influence of global warming here, and I'm sure we'll talk about Pinot Noir in a minute, but I wonder if sites where varieties are planted, if that's maybe up for kind of reconsideration a little bit. We had a very interesting producer at dinner last night who is out certainly on the fringe of Leo, where on the fringe of where things are planted and what's possible, but sort of forging ahead and breaking new ground. I wonder if there's some, if there is room for a bit of that work to be done here. I don't know, I'm just putting it out there.
I think that at least if you talk to the producers, that a lot of people are doing things where, but they're still using old formulas in the vineyard, and certainly people have to tweak the way they grow their vines, or reduce crops, or pick earlier. There's a lot of variables that people are still tweaking.
That came up a bit, didn't it? The yield thing certainly came up a bit.
So I think that people are figuring it out, but there's also market forces that people went that way. And if I dare say it, even I remember I started tasting Alsace in the early 90s and tasting, great vintages of the 80s and all the 90s. This was with the Wine Spectator, and I came here every year, and there were so many more dry wines. And then there was a change. I think some of it was market driven, higher yields, the sweetness could cover the faults. Also, some like Robert Parker loved really sweet and thick wines, and so a lot of people moved in that direction, but there's a lot of people moving away from it, and we'll see what happens with the new generation coming on board. But still it's a bit of a minefield here. And I think that what's interesting is across the board, varieties, I think clearly Riesling is fantastic still, and I think less sweet wines. Pinot Gris seems to really have a lot of sweeter style wines that aren't marked as such. And then Gewürz, we had some excellent Gewürz, but of course sometimes they can be sweet because people don't want to have 15, you know, over 15 degrees alcohol. So again, I think that, and then Pinot Noir, we have some amazing Pinot Noirs nowadays because of the temperature, the average temperature of it has increased so much. A couple of producers said that in the last 40 years, the harvesting date has increased by 5 to 6 weeks, where they used to harvest in late October, and now they're harvesting in mid-September.
Mm.
So that's really fascinating to me, and it shows the changes in the climate. But in a good way, it's really improved the quality of Pinot Noir. I remember in the 90s, coming here, the early 90s, and Pinot Noir was always just like a light red that you would drink slightly chilled in brasseries. And in Paris, that's how it was also in the 80s when I lived in France. And now you see serious wines with really their own character, where it's not emulating or trying to copy Burgundy. It has a much more flinty, minerally, smoky style due to their unique and complex terroirs and microclimates. So I think Pinot Noir is a really big story here now, and an exciting thing that I always look for now. And I really try to turn people onto that, because that's something new that a lot of people wouldn't even think about.
Yeah, I mean, it took me by surprise in a really good way to see the Pinots here. The other really amazing thing, I think, was the Gewürztraminer Terminer wines from 2017. They are just like, that's a vintage that has produced, I think, an abundance of mm-hmm. really exciting Gewürz. And
this is Riesling 17 too.
Gewürz that's really expressive, really complex, just so seductively just shining, you know, doing all the things that it's meant to do. 2017 Gewürz is definitely a good find mm-hmm. this time. What did you like?
Well, I was particularly impressed also with, you know, I think people who know Alsace will know how strong it is on organic and biodynamic wines there. And I think this has really become a hub for, things which are organic, and then moving a slightly more to a sort of natural wine zone. But in general, I found, with some exceptions, that the wines were fairly, very well made. The natural wines, so-called natural wines, were very, very clean, and they were, yeah, really great examples. I think just the climate here works so well with
it's
that. Right,
it's very dry wine region in the scheme of things, exactly. In France, isn't it?
Yeah. And getting even more and more so. I mean, it was very interesting. We were having a discussion yesterday with Mark Hugel, and he was saying how, in the last few years, they've had very little botrytis at all, just because it gets drier and drier and drier. And in 2017, it's a perfect example. It's a very, very dry vintage. So,
and 17 is definitely a year that you should seek out. It was less good in many other areas, like Burgundy, slightly overproduction, but good quality. 17 and Bordeaux, less exciting, but some good quality wines. But it seems they really did well here, and it was dry, and they produced fantastic wines, and dry, so wines were ripe but still maintained acidity, so very unique wines. Production was slightly reduced, so I'm definitely going to look for 17, both red and white. 16 is a more bountiful crop, good quality wines. 15, slightly better, drier, riper vintage. 14, I'm not a huge fan of.
16 drink, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's like drink, open. Drink them.
14 had problems with Suzuki Fly. The wines are really all over the map. And then 13, excellent, excellent wines. 12, excellent. And then 18, sort of mixed reports, but we didn't really taste any, so that's not a big deal. So anyways, there's a lot of good vintages to check out, and I think 17 is really the one to look for now as they come onto the market. And then again, as we said, I guess for me, in the tasting, 500 wines was the Pinot Noirs, and that was really exciting. And again, as Jack, as you were saying, this whole movement for biodynamically, wines made from biodynamically grown grapes, organic wines, organically grown grapes, it's a very dynamic place and really undervalued.
It is kind of like the, it's funny, you know, with that biodynamic philosophy, often there's, like, it's accompanied by this great attention to detail and this real intimacy in terms of what's happening in the vineyard, and I'm sure that's happening here, but it's almost like, I don't know, I feel there's some sort of disconnect between, like, almost like taking their hands off the wheel and saying, well, hey, these are the styles that we're kind of being delivered. And you know, I don't know. I wonder if there's a new generation. You know, we met Julian Trimbach last night, and I wonder if there is a new generation that will come in and sort of reorient some of the sort of stylistic pathways here. I think it's going to be a really interesting place in the next, you know, 5, 8, maybe 10 years.
But I don't believe, for example, the stuff that I've read in New York Times about all this, the hocus pocus about how biodynamic and organic growers are making sweet wines because they are using natural yeast and the yeast don't ferment dry. And we asked a lot of winemakers about them. They just laughed. They said, well, you just have to be patient. Mm-hmm. You know, it may take 6-8 months for them to completely ferment dry.
Or 3 years.
Yeah, I mean, in one instance, there was a sweet wine like that. But I think that we can't blame people organically or biodynamically growing grapes or trying to make natural wines for this trend for sweetness, because it actually started well before then. I would say late 1990s or early 2000s. So I can't really say, I don't think we have a handle on saying that the movement now is towards dry. I think the only thing you can say is the movement is towards excellent Pinot Noirs.
I think we all want it to move towards dry. Yeah. I think we're willing it to move towards dry.
Yeah, exactly.
In some way, do you agree?
Yeah, but people clearly aren't doing that. And I can say for the last 5-6 years since tasting, it's not looking like that.
But there are a lot of myths out there as well. I mean, you speak to some of the, you know, sommelier crowd here, and they have some quite interesting views on these things. I mean, there's the one that says, well, you know, the reason that we have to keep them slightly off dry is because otherwise the alcohol would be too high, right? I don't really personally, I don't know what you guys think, but I don't personally really buy that argument when you consider there are many areas in the world which are much hotter than ourselves. I mean, we were just in Australia. Eden Valley is a perfect example. Nick and I were talking about that yesterday. I think really actually it's more to do with getting lower ripeness in the grapes, you know, getting lower brick. So that can mean obviously harvesting earlier. It can mean slightly higher yields. You know, there are different things that you can do on that.
I think yield's got to have something. There's got to be something in there, and perhaps that's linked to, you know, what's happening in the market, what people can, you know, what the average producer can sell their wines for. Maybe, I don't know. Like, it's a big thing to try and thread, but it's certainly possible.
For sure.
Well, I think everything's possible here with such a variety of grape types and different types of producers, very diverse soils. An interesting Grand Cru system that people are always debating as well. But you can see a lot of internal turmoil, and it's always been like that in Alsace, where different villages have strong views. There's even Protestant and Catholic villages, mm-hmm. and there's all sorts of, for hundreds of years, there's been this conflict. So the wines can be a little bit conflicted, but they're also very soulful and historical mm-hmm. wines. That's why we keep on coming back. And of course, I like to come back too, because my glasses are made here, the Lalique James Suckling 100 points wines, and so they're big supporters of what we do in Alsace. So it's always a great time here to taste these wines and meet these fascinating producers.
Some great food here too, some amazing restaurants.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Not always the lightest cuisine in the world, but
we bring our own.
Don't come here if you want to lose a few pounds.
And if you like spicy food, you need to bring BYO chili, definitely.
Okay, so that wraps it up from Alsace. I hope you enjoyed the conversation. And try some of the bottles. Go out there. I would recommend right away trying a Alsace Riesling. And preferably from 17, but 15, 16, there's lots of good things. And they age really well.
Amazingly.
So, yeah, don't worry about age. As long as it's been stored well, you're going to have a great bottle. And look for the Pinots if you can find them.
Yeah.
Really, really Pinot Noir is really, really interesting. Small production, but if you can get your hands on them, you know, go for it.
And value, too. The value in Alsace Pinot.
Well, compared to Burgundy, anything's of value. But... Okay, well, thanks again, and we'll look forward to hooking up in our next podcast.